back here. I will be back here. And I will be back with another vengeance.
Yeah, we'll lick our wounds. We'll get over this. We'll be fired up for next year.
Garoppolo has time, stands in, going deep, going for it. Oh, and it's caught for the touchdown! On fourth down, Deebo Samuel for six. Garoppolo's got all day. He's going to launch it deep down the field, going for it all, and getting it! Emmanuel Sanders, not touched, still on his feet, inside the 10, and he scores! 75-yard bomb from Jimmy Garoppolo to Emmanuel Sanders. Wilson, pressure off the edge, releases it, and it is intercepted by Greenlaw. Trey Greenlaw, now on the return, as he's still on his feet with blockers in front. Trey Greenlaw down the sideline. Can you believe this?
Looks like football, baby.
Pass is caught. Kittle breaks one tackle. Another. Wow, what a touchdown for George Kittle. Not throws, and it's intercepted. It's picked off by Warner. Fred Warner for the touchdown. Jeff Wilson has come in at running back. Garoppolo's throw is caught by Jeff Wilson. He's going to score a touchdown for the 49ers.
And the pass is going to be picked off by Bosa. Nick Bosa. Can't bring him down till he gets to the 8-yard line. Wow.
Now Evans in the slot. Winston picked off. And it's Richard Sherman, who did not have an interception last year. And he returns it all the way for a 49ers touchdown, 32 yards.
Garoppolo fires. It is caught. Still on his feet is Kittle with a big play. And the stiff arm. George Kittle. Flags fly. He's down to the 30. What a run by George Kittle. Taking on everybody.
Howdy, gold-blooded cunts. Daddy here. This is the Gold-Blooded Podcast. Bi-week special. I don't know, week two? I don't know how to fucking say it. We don't have any game to talk about, but we got some shit to talk about. I am Joey I, your host. I am joined by my number one friend, Mr. Bobby Digital, also known as Rob, and our friend Michael Instagram Curran up in Maine. Say hi, Mike.
Hello.
And here I am yelling out of the gate for the first time today. I've been talking at normal pace or normal volume until we start, and then I start yelling. So, lots of shit happened in the NFL this weekend. I don't know that we'll talk about a lot of that. We definitely have news, injuries, and updates to get to. All sorts of wacky shit going on with our boys, the San Francisco Football 49ers. Gonna throw a little curveball at you, Rob. Hey, motherfuckers, we didn't get in a lot of emails this week, and that's maybe because there was no game, but fuck you. Email us, goldbloodedpodcast@gmail.com. I want everybody to email us and tell us why you didn't email in during the bye week. Check out our Instagram. Michael Curran runs it. I put some shit up there. It's Goldblooded Podcast, one word. If you are one of the upper class in this country or your country, wherever you may be listening to us, we'd appreciate some ducats sent our way. If you're a adamant listener and you get down with this bitch week in and week out and you like what we do, well, you know, go to Patreon, www.patreon.com/goldbloodedpodcast. You know, make us a little donation for the kids. You know, we're going to put it back into this bitch. I know we have friends in Australia, Russia, India, there's two of you. You know, there's a couple of yous out there. Ghana. I don't know what the fuck's going on. But, if you have money, send it to us. We'd appreciate it. The reviews, you fuckers. However it is that you listen to us, whether it be Apple, Stitcher. What's the one Joe Rogan just went to?
Spotify.
Spotify, whatever. Go there. leave a little review. It helps us, you know? I mean, it helps us without you paying us. If you won't pay us, at least fucking make a free review, you twats. All right. With that said, does anybody else have anything to say?
Well, we want to get into the fun, huh?
I mean, I could keep talking about bullshit, but yeah, let's get this started so we can talk about our fun.
Okay.
All right.
All right.
Giddy up.
Okay.
Hey.
We claimed defensive lineman Tackarist McKinley off of waivers from the Bengals.
Am I wrong or is his nickname Tank? Did I get Tack. That? Tack. Oh, I thought I read it wrong.
Then we placed defensive tackle Javon Kinlaw on the reserve COVID-19 list. You may remember from last time we had placed Eric Armstead on that list prior to recording last week.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're expecting to see him this week.
Wait.
Okay. Sorry.
Placed offensive lineman Ronis Grasu and linebacker Joe Walker on the reserve COVID-19 list. Then we waived failed physical defensive lineman Tackarist McKinley after we claimed him. You may remember the Bengals claimed him and then waived him also. And I think the Raiders are the most recent to claim him after we waived him.
Okay.
And what I read was, or what I heard was, much like when you evaluate a player, a team might cut a player or release a player, and another team may see value in that player that the other team didn't.
Okay.
You know, John Harbaugh might see a player and go, oh, I can do something with that guy after Kyle Shanahan said, nah, I don't want anything to do with this guy.
Right.
And it goes the same for doctors. They want their doctors that they trust to look at him and go, yes absolutely. Or no.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's where that comes from. Because everyone was like, why do we claim him if he just failed the physical?
Right.
But we want to weigh the options too, because if he's going to get better this offseason, maybe we still want to spend the money for next year.
Yeah, absolutely.
And for us, that's probably a no-go because of where we're at money-wise, and we got guys like Nick Bosa coming back. We probably wanted a guy this year.
Absolutely.
The Raiders might want him for next year.
But again, you still got to have your doctors take a look. Yeah. You know, you're not going to trust somebody else, but yeah.
We then placed wide receiver Brandon Ayuk, tight end Daniel Helm, and tackle Trent Williams on the reserve COVID-19 list. Then we waived failed physical linebacker Kiko Alonso. Some people were surprised by this because we had just traded him, just got him in that trade.
Yeah.
I'm not at all surprised by that. I think that was probably favor for the Saints.
Yeah.
It was probably us taking him from the Saints and then us cutting him instead of them cutting him.
Right.
And them taking, it was probably a favor. Take Quan Alexander's contract off our hands. We'll get rid of Kiko Alonso for you. I'm just guessing. I don't know. I don't know how that works.
Sure.
We then placed defensive lineman DJ Jones and defensive lineman Jordan Willis on the reserve COVID-19 list.
Oh, geez,
so that. We're up to Armstead, Kinlaw, Grasu, Walker, Ayuk, Helm, Trent Williams, DJ Jones, and Jordan Willis. I'm up to 9 by my count.
Okay. Are you going to talk about this or can I interrupt you about this? Okay.
Signed safety Chris Edwards to a 1-year deal.
Okay.
Signed safety Kai Nukua. Probably should have had you pronounce that. Should I put the let's get rid of this?
Nakua.
And wide receiver Sean Poindexter to the team's practice squad. I've read this name before. We must have signed and cut him a couple times. Yeah. We did open the injured reserve practice window for running back Raheem Mostert and running back Jeff Wilson.
That's yeah, papa.
John Lynch, Patrick Willis, and Bryant Young were all named semifinalists for the Pro Football Hall of Fame class of 2021. I think that's Patrick Willis' first, right?
Because he's only been out of the 5 years, right? Yeah. And so, I saw Peyton Manning as well.
That's a first ballot.
Yeah, but I mean, I guess it's just 5 years for both those guys. Mm-hmm. What the fuck? Yeah.
And news today came out that Kaywan Williams is suspended for 2 games for PED violation. Now, he's also injured, so I don't know how that works. I don't know if he's got to come off of injured reserve first. Or was he injured reserve, or was he just inactive? We might have kept him on the...
Yeah, but I thought it was 4 games for PEDs.
And maybe second violation is 4 games, but the release today said 2 games.
Okay, so what do you got?
So for the COVID-19 list, what scares me is that guys aren't coming off of it.
Oh, we would get updates that they come off it?
Yes.
Okay.
So that's the scary part. News did drop yesterday that Trent Williams tested positive, that it wasn't a close relative thing.
So he has it.
He has it.
So he's out then.
Yeah, and he also is a cancer survivor, so he's a little bit high risk.
Yep.
So that's a little concerning for him.
Yeah.
Ayuk was part of the close encounters for Kendrick Bourne.
right?
And so was Trent Williams.
Right, because they all
lived
together.
So they may travel together. So if Williams tested positive, it's possible that Ayuk is just a contact tracing. I'm just reading into it, though.
Yeah.
But none of these, I haven't seen anyone come off of it yet, which is scary. Now, there is a catch with the COVID-19 list. Normal roster changes have to happen before Sunday. You can't add someone to the roster or take them off on game day Sunday.
Okay.
You can on game day Monday if it's a Monday night football game. But you cannot change your roster on game day Sunday.
Okay.
Except for COVID-19.
Except if they were placed on the, whatever you call it, the reserve/COVID list.
Or
right?
They can go on it. So let's say someone tests positive Sunday morning.
Right.
And you have to put them on it. You can add a guy in place of them that day also. But like, to come back, I forget how many negative tests you have to have. If their last negative test is Sunday morning, they can come on the roster and play.
Gotcha.
And that's what happened with the Raiders. I don't know if you saw the Raiders were like borderline.
Right.
And they got their guys back like so, last minute.
I mean, I got to imagine we're going to be in a beyond borderline situation.
Yeah, it's bad news.
How does the... So, did you see the Ravens have had a bunch of positive tests? It seems like this is going to be the week when the wheels fall off for the NFL. Would we if all agree gonna. With that? Yeah.
I would go as far to say it may... This may be the start of it.
Right.
Because I think this is probably the start of it for the country. It's probably going to be a big surge in the next couple weeks.
Yeah.
And then maybe after Christmas it starts to die down.
Right. Yeah. I can't imagine. I mean, how does the Niners play this game? First of all, we could all say as fans that we got absolutely fucked that game against the Packers. Right? No. Trent Williams, no Ayuk, none of them, whatever the case was.
But at the same time, if you're in a COVID-19 year and you're worried about catching it from people, maybe having three players live together is not the fucking brightest move.
Right, yeah.
You know, like, especially three guys that are important. If one of them goes, you lose all of them.
Right.
Put them in a fucking hotel room, do something.
Them. Yeah.
Like, if you lose Kendrick Bourne and that costs you your number two wide receiver, who's your number one wide receiver because your number one is injured, and your left tackle... Somebody's not doing something smart here.
That was my next question. What's Debo's status?
I believe he's possible.
Okay.
I haven't gotten, because we record on Tuesday,
right.
It's tough to get those updates.
I gotcha. I didn't know if anybody
All those guys are possible. Sherman, Debo.
Oh, I saw something that more or less said Sherman was playing, but he'll probably get COVID. All right. Yeah, I mean, I feel that we were absolutely railroaded that fucking Packers game. It was the Thursday night game. We were so short-staffed because of Corona. You know, they changed all these other fucking games around, but then gave the Niners no fucking love. They give them a short week, and they took at least five guys away from us that game.
Honestly, I think that's why we had no leeway is because it was Thursday. If it was Sunday, the NFL's got other games for people to watch.
Yeah.
But on Thursday night, you take a primetime game away, it's all money. They've got advertisers that have paid for that spot. They've got...
Yeah, but then they got a shit game instead. I don't know, whatever. I mean, money in the bank is money in the bank. But I just think it was not... I mean, sportsmanship-wise, it wasn't even close to fair. It was fucking horseshit. But I'm a baby anyway. And we're going to fucking prove that theory when we talk about this next thing. The bye week special. Rob, how do you want to handle this?
You tell me. I got the sheet up here.
I know, but you're the boss, and I'd like you to give me some direction in this sense here.
You want to send this to Curran?
No, not yet.
Okay. You want to just start from the beginning? We show up to the field. We're back on Goose Shit Field.
Yeah, we went back to Goose Shit Field.
I brought a couple cheerleaders this time.
I had my baby there as well. She also did a little babysitting, which was good. She spent a lot of time with children this week. That's good. Curran, I guess let's start with baby boy. How's that? Curran, tell us about your day until your computer.
Yeah, how'd you find a field? What do you got?
Drove around for a little bit. I was completely unprepared with that. I felt like I've got the full gold-blooded podcast experience of trying to find a field, thinking you found the field, and it being completely not the field you want. But yeah, I eventually found a nice open field with a track around it, had the numbers still like on the turf, obviously. So it was a turf field. And yeah, I found a good field.
Now, did you have a track on the field?
Yes.
Now, did you run your 40 on the track or the grass?
I ran my 40 on the grass.
And the mile on the track?
I did not run smile there.
Wait, what?
Because I was nervous that I don't trust you guys with this, because I feel like I went back and listened. I never heard anything about ANnuAL. So instead of doing it there, I went to the gym later and just did it on the treadmill as my normal run and timed it, and that's what I sent to you.
Disqualified.
Okay. So I still...
A treadmill.
Disqualified. What do you mean?
That's cheating. Running on a treadmill is not the same as running... No, you are not going to sit here as a grown man and tell me that running on a treadmill is the same as running on
running around.
Why don't you do your 40 on the treadmill then?
Sorry.
Because I can't go start speed all the way. It's the
bullshit.
Same thing.
You cheated. You're disqualified.
Well, I'm not going to be so heavy-handed on him, Rob. But,
I mean...
He came in last anyway.
I was going to say, if you thought that I was actually going to run, if you look at the time as well, I'm pretty sure I came last in the mile. So if I ran on regular track, it would have been better, worse. I think it would have been the same.
No, it definitely would have been worse, first of all. No one runs the same speed on a treadmill or the track. That's like a known.
Not necessarily. But
let's go on. Let's ask the internet. It's definitely not the same.
Okay. But well, regardless,
And especially to a non-runner, because it's more wear and tear,
right,
on ground than on a treadmill.
But how upset are we really gonna get? He came in last anyway. The only person he didn't lose to was Chris.
I want to backtrack a little though.
Okay, let's backtrack.
Curran said something in the beginning of his statement. He said he was unprepared.
Yeah,
and I would like to second that. If I could draw your attention to the screen, Joe.
Okay. Curran, you're going to get fucking rocked here, bud. Sorry.
The 2020 NFL schedule was released on May 7th, 2020.
Yeah.
So we've known since May 7th.
Yeah.
June, July, August, September, October. No, that's 6+ months we knew when this date was going to be, right?
Yeah.
Curran couldn't find a way to get it done.
No.
6+ months.
Rob, we've been over this.
Okay.
No,
I'm not done.
That's not my fault.
Oh, yeah, 100% is your fault.
Yeah.
I'm not nearly done.
Okay.
And here's why I'm not done.
Mm-hmm.
How many days prior to the... I'll give you a week, even though it wasn't a week.
Yeah.
Let's say a week.
Let's say it was Tuesday, so 5 days.
I'll give him a week. A week prior to the competition.
I'd say 5 to 7.
Mr. Curran says, I can't make it. I have two options. I can meet you halfway.
Yeah.
Or I can compete on my own field. I'm 100% down to drive and meet halfway.
Yeah.
On 5 days' notice.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I was.
Not 6.5 months' notice, but 5 days' notice.
Right.
I have 3 kids.
Yes.
And a wife.
Yes.
And a yard of leaves that need to be cleaned up sometime. Yeah. But I'm willing to make this drive. But we know from past experience, as Curran found out, you can't just show up at a field and compete. You'll get kicked out. Yeah. It's a fucking disaster.
You can't take that chance.
We've done this.
We've
almost canceled one because we drove to so many goddamn fields.
The only theory I thought on that was calling some of your friends in Boston.
Yeah.
And seeing if we could lock something in, because that would be halfway. But then that was silly.
But Curran let us know that he was able to get Sunday off and couldn't make it.
Yeah.
Everyone else associated with this podcast, except probably Chris, Steve, Joe, myself, would have driven down Saturday night, competed in this contest Sunday morning,
you boot,
and drove home after the contest. We were done by 11:30, 12 o'clock.
Yeah.
And gone to work Monday. Not Curran. Curran was not prepared for this contest. Played on his home turf for his very first podcast competition. And then cheated on the mile.
But do we...
And this is why we made you run a mile.
Yeah, we never ran a mile, Curran.
I knew it.
Well, we didn't even make him run a mile.
Yeah. Well,
he just did his normal fucking gym workout and said, I ran a mile. He did his fucking cardio for the week and told us I ran a mile on the treadmill.
I assumed you figured we were completely fucking with you. You saw the times that I had given you and you just put yourself last. That's what I assumed you did.
Also, bullshit that those mile times are accurate.
Why?
No way.
No way what? I can't run a mile in 8.5 minutes?
I really don't. That's quick, yo.
Curran, when I was in...
Okay,
when I ran track, I ran a sub 6-minute mile.
Okay.
And I know I can't run a sprint now, but I bet I could run a mile in under 7.5 minutes.
Okay. So.
But regardless, that was your punishment.
Sure.
If we call it punishment, all he did was his normal fucking workout, and then he said I ran a mile and counted it.
I just needed the time. Listen, all right. You're right. I am sorry.
If I could draw your attention to the screen once again.
To answer your question, treadmill running and road running are not quite the same. Running on a treadmill is easier than running outdoors for a variety of reasons. One reason is that the treadmill belt assists leg turnover, making it easier to run faster. Because treadmill running is easier, use it for speed work. Yeah, he's got you there, Kern.
Yeah, you cheated. You cheated.
And you still lost.
All right, so let's move on to some stuff that we actually did.
So, Kerr, we're sorry that we made you do that, but if you would
have... We didn't make him do anything. He didn't even do it. He cheated.
Well, again, but...
I'm not sorry at all.
Okay. Neither...
I'll go one step further. Okay. If he actually ran a mile on the track, I still wouldn't be sorry.
Right. But I guess...
Exactly. So it's a lose-lose situation. So whatever. I'm not sad at what I did, but
you should be sad at your lack of commitment to this podcast.
The best way to say it is... The best way to say it is, you would have never had to run anything had you just came down.
But I...
Curran.
Okay.
Curran, go. Hold on. Listen. I got to tell you one more thing. Sorry. You met my wife, right? Mm-hmm. Interesting gal, right? But she's learned over the years, right, that when she's wrong, the best way with me...
With anyone!
With me and him, especially.
This is a construction site thing.
Just sit there and shut the fuck up.
This is a construction site thing.
Yeah.
Here's the shovel. Put the shovel down.
Yeah.
And stop fucking digging.
Yeah.
It's a construction site thing.
Current. But you got something to say. The floor is yours.
You ever work construction?
Good answer!
I've worked with people like that, but it's whatever. I got you. All right. You know what? Next year, I'll get another job. I'll have a better boss.
Like all you had to do is drive down Saturday night and compete and drive home.
Oh, but that's all right.
Yeah.
All right.
No, you're not committed.
Would you have driven
to Maine if the roles were reversed?
Hold on. Let's just take a look at
it is like a 5-hour drive though.
Lack of commitment.
But I drove 5 hours today. Almost. And I'm here. Trust me, the last thing I wanted to do was come here tonight. Like I was like, I'm gonna lie and say I'm sick. I'm gonna do something. But I'm here. But nevertheless, Curran.
There's always next year. Maybe in May 2021 when we find out when our bye week will be in 2021, you can make it work.
No, seriously, next year I'm going to call your boss personally and let them know that you're needed. I'm going to call her in May. May 7th.
The day after the schedule comes out.
I'm calling him. And I'm going to say, hey, I'm his other boss. I need him on this week. And then I'll hash it out with her for you. Trust me, I have a way with people. You could talk now. We're just breaking your balls.
No, I'm my shovel's down. My shovel's down.
Good. All right. Even better.
All right.
Then.
Well done.
All right. Very well. Well, for then, can we at least tell him what place he came in then?
Well, I think we should go through the whole thing, and at the end, everyone will know their places.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll tell you this.
Steve knows he won, but.
You did much better than me. So I'll tell you that, Kern.
You had a good showing in your first.
Yeah, you did. Really. You killed it.
You had a good job.
I had a depressing day.
Ah, fuck you!
Dude, I sat on the field like for 10 minutes after the whole thing was over, and I was like, "I'm really disappointed in myself, and I can't kick another ball."
Did you have that scene from Boogie Nights when Philip Seymour Hoffman, when he tries to kiss Dirk Diggler and he gets denied? He goes out to the car. He's like crying.
I'm a fucking idiot.
Oh, yeah. It's been a while since I've seen that.
I really wanted to show up, and I was just...
You did. You had a good show.
No, dude, you totally showed. You were the only one... Well, no, not at all. All
right, I don't know the results, so I'll say stuff after.
Should we just send... You want me to send him those now?
Mm-mm.
No, okay.
We'll read through them.
Okay. I'll send them to you after. So... The way we always do it every year is we get together and we start just kicking balls, having fun, right?
As a warm up, but they count if they go through.
Yeah, for distance. So I came out of the gate hot. I hit two 20-yard field goals, which is a shocker for me. Then I hit a 25-yard field goal on maybe my 10th attempt all day. That was then the longest ball I made all day. Rob and Steve weren't having all that much luck with distance in the beginning. I held that lead for at least a couple events. The first event we got into was the best of 10, right?
Yeah. This is where I'm disappointed in myself. Because
I'm shocked at you. 2 years in a row.
It's because I try too hard to not try hard.
Yeah. It's unfortunate because you would have...
If we compete next week, I feel like I could crush anything kicking because at the end of the session, I was dialed in.
Right. So in the best of 10, Chris came in last with 0 out of 10 for just not even showing up. Rob,
yeah, I was gonna say, wait, Chris didn't show up.
We gave him last.
He had the same amount of time as you. At least you found a field to compete on.
Yeah, he could have. Hell, if he wanted to go to fucking Meriden and video himself, he could have. Rob came in fourth place, making 4 out of 10. I had my worst showing in years. I've always made at least 7 out of 10. I only made 5 out of 10 this year. And Stephen Curran tied at nine fucking balls apiece, 9 out of 10.
It's a good showing in your first one.
Yeah, agreed. Now, what order did you, what was your first event?
I went 10 for 10 as well.
That was the first thing you did?
Did you warm up first?
Yeah, did you warm up at all? Or?
Yes, I did three in a row, and I was like, okay, I think I can get the kind of control of this and understand how to just kick it through every time, and then I immediately went in 10 for 10. I think I missed my, like, seventh one. I just pretty much barely hit it off the tee. So, but yeah, no, that one came pretty easy, and then I started feeling confident, and then...
So first of all, Steve missed his second ball and then managed to drill 7 in a row to finish, which was pretty impressive. So the next event we did was the throwing accuracy. And as you learned how to do it and as we learned, what we do is we stand on the goal line. We took a hash mark 15 yards out and we placed a screwdriver in the ground at that hash mark. And then we threw balls at the hash mark. Or at the screwdriver, and the other two guys who weren't competing were marking the balls where they landed, and then we were marking them with screwdrivers, and then whatever that person, you get 5 throws, whatever the thrower's closest throw is, we then measure. So Chris came in last again. I just gave him 50 inches away from the target, as that was longest.
Yeah, realistically, it was probably like 25 miles.
Yeah, maybe more, but yeah. Rob... surprising here, came in fourth again with a measurement of 32.5 inches. I came in third again at 30.5 inches, beating Rob by 2 inches. Steve beat us both, coming in second place at 20.25. And Curran, you ended up, it was 13 inches and like 9.982 the way it broke down. So I just called it 14. So, Curran won. Curran, you won that event at 14 inches. Now, who had you had Libby marking for you?
No. So, we've had a bit of a COVID / reserve IR situation up here.
Oh.
With, just kind of contact, making sure everyone's safe. So, I was here alone, and I had Mama Curran come with me.
Oh, that's phenomenal.
And she literally just went with me, but
because I feel like she would be more honest than his girlfriend. Yeah, I was, you know what I mean.
I was curious before that. That makes me feel a little better.
Yeah. Okay.
No, she came with me
because I'm so curious.
I'm still sorry.
You know, I'm a bit of a conspiracy theorist, and for a guy to come out of the gates and do so well his first event, his first
two events,
his first competition, and after opting not to come do it with. With unbiased onlookers.
Unbiased.
I was a little, you know.
Unbiased eyes.
Yeah, I was a little curious. We'll just say that.
But you feel better now knowing
that? A little, yeah.
I feel a little
better. I also feel like he could have lied about the distance if he wanted to lie.
Yeah.
You know? Like he didn't have to come up with 28.
20. Oh, on that?
Yeah, like he could have went longer. We would have believed him.
Yeah,
but if he was gonna lie, he could have lied more. So I don't think he lied.
No, I don't think he lied. No, I think he was on point.
Now, if he told me he didn't have someone else there to measure, throwing out the accuracy.
All of it. Oh, I'm throwing all the distances too, because there's just no way. But yeah, no, and I feel better at being Mama Curran. I like your girlfriend a lot, but I think she would, you know, she might... We had a conspiracy with Baby a few years ago where she ran a stop clock fucked up, and it ended up being in my favor, and everybody held it against me. But what do you want me to do? All right. Next event was punting distance.
I got you. Nope. I had the most honest person to literally tell you guys. So
good deal. Okay.
I told you I wanted to make sure it was good.
So Chris came in last again with a 0-yard punt. Curran came in fourth here. He had a 30-yard punt. I came in third. So far, I've came in third in the first three events at 33 yards, 28 inches. Rob came in fourth at a 41 yards, 4 inches. And Steve, the fucking big boot, came out on top at 45 yards straight up.
Oh, he did get it?
The punting,
oh,
yes.
Oh, no.
That
caught. Oh, the punting.
Yes.
With a taped foot.
Yeah, his
cleats came unsold.
Yeah, like he had the duck bill going with his cleats. He had to tape them. And then he took silver, like, duck work tape and taped his fucking shoe up.
Did you wear cleats?
I wore cleats. I was on turf as well. I would have slipped and slide everywhere if
was it wet up there?
No, it was nice.
Yeah, we had a couple raindrops, but it wasn't. It was a little chilly, but it wasn't bad. Okay, so...
The field that I went and played at, it's kind of at like a more of a, I don't know if it's not really a rich school, but like their facility is nice and the field is, you know, pretty renovated. So.
Gotcha. Okay. So the next event that we did was the throwing distance. Chris, 0 yards again. Rob threw for 30 yards, 4 inches. I threw for 34 yards, 10 inches. Mr. Curran came in at 39 yards, and Steve beat him out by 1 yard at 40 yards. So this is definitely a Steve and Curran show up to this point. Then we have the 40-yard dash.
Then it goes down.
So with the 40-yard dash, Chris ran a 10-minute dash. I got a terrible start because my wife is a dumb fuck. And it doesn't understand cadence. So I had a terrible start and just, I was never going to win that fucking thing anyway. I just gave myself 10 seconds. Curran came in at 6.19. Rob came in at 6.12. Steve came in at 5.84. So, as we learned earlier, Michael Curran was the only member of the GBP to run the mile in any capacity, whether it be a... I figured you were going to know it was a joke and you were just going to take a time that seemed longer than ours and just not run it. That's what I would have done.
I predicted you going back to listen, too.
Yeah, we knew you were good. Because we... Yeah.
I really was... I had like thought about it all week. I'm like, am I really going to go out here and do this or should I just listen back? And I just never ended up listening back. But I was like, man, I've been listening.
Like we were going to add more until you sniffed out the mile.
Yeah, like because you questioned it and we just bullied through
it. We had a longer list we were going to give you.
We were going to do push-ups and sit-ups. We were going to make it like a combine thing. We were going to make you see how high you could jump.
This is so disappointing, though, because he didn't even fucking do it.
I mean, he's still...
No, he didn't. No, anyone that's ever run on a track and a fucking treadmill...
I understand.
It's just not... First of all, he goes to the gym and does cardio anyways.
Curran, when was the last time you went to the gym?
When I told you that I ran the mile.
No, but before that?
Like 2 days before that.
And you ran?
I didn't run then.
Oh, when was the last time you ran?
The day that I told you.
Before that.
You mean before that?
Yes.
Oh, what?
Do you run often?
Kind of. I do cardio more.
He just fucking did his workout.
But all I'm saying to you is he still did more than you or I.
Yeah, but that's not the point. That's not
I know.
The point
well,
if you went to the gym and got on a treadmill and ran a mile.
But he also knew we were completely full of shit.
That's punishment.
Yeah.
If you went to the gym, got on a treadmill and ran a mile, that's punishment for you. It's not punishment for him. It's just his fucking cardio workout.
I hear you.
It wasn't a good prank is all I'm saying. We didn't get the payoff we wanted. The payoff I wanted was this fool running around a fucking track in a field.
I'm satisfied. I mean, whatever. Whatever. Listen, maybe I'd be happier if I didn't come in fucking nearly last to Chris, who didn't even compete. You know what I mean? So I'm fucking bitter here. Okay.
Well, let's move on to the headline event.
Yeah, the headline event, which is the field goal distance, which is worth double the points. I came in fucking... Oh, Chris came in dead last with a zero-yard field goal. I came in fourth, 25-yarder. Curran beat me by 3 yards at 28. Steve only came
before
up...
Before you go on, I want you to look at the... Oh, I got the history up also.
Okay. Steve came through with a 30-yard field goal, which is surprising because he's had some long field goals in the past. You should make that 42 because it was damn near 42. 7/8. I don't know how you know what I mean. It was... So then, can I say it?
You just said it.
Well, no. Okay. So Rob set the record this year.
New record, Curran.
New motherfucking record. Previously, the record was Rob from 2015. Our very first, when he banged a 40-yarder. The following year, Steve topped out at 39, and Rob took the crown the next year in 2017 with 35. Then Steve took this event in 2018 and 19 with 36 and 37 yards. But this year, Rob topped them all at 41 yards and 19 inches, nearly 42 yards. It was a fucking bomb. It looked very professional.
No, it clanked.
Oh, that's right. It clanked. It
went through. Wait, did the 40 clank? No, the 40 clanked.
Right.
The 40 clanked at the other end.
Yeah, the first end.
The 42 cleared.
Yeah, the 42 cleared on the with the wind?
Yeah.
Okay.
The 41 hit the upright and bounced over.
Yeah,
it was... My 40 that put me in the lead, it hit the crossbar and then went over. But my 42 cleared.
Yeah,
okay. I had another couple on that.
Okay. So, with all that added up, the totals are Chris, 7 points. Should I do the point fives or just round up on those?
Add up.
Round up, yeah. I had 18 points, which was fucking pathetic. Rob came in at 24 points. Michael Curran came in with 25 points. And Steve came in with 32 points.
He retains his belt, which we have possession of.
Somewhere. And really, really, out of all the years we've competed, this is straight up, I feel the worst about myself than I've felt in any prior year.
And you felt the best going in.
I did. No, I don't know if I felt the best, but I was the most
confident.
Yeah, because I came in second last year, and I thought if I'm in a good spot mentally, I think that's always my problem. But I just didn't have it. Wasn't my day. So I had a long talk with Baby, and the conclusion was...
I'm going to tell you, the reason... I wonder if Curran doesn't compete, you might have beat me. Because it throws off your numbers so much. You might have been... It would have been closer, that's for sure.
Yeah, I don't care about that.
Because anytime he's in between... Like, right. He's in between you and me, it bumped you down.
Yeah, for sure. But that's not really... That really only... It happened on the 40, the field goal distance.
I'll say this. Your potential... Let me think how I want to put this.
I call it
ceiling.
Yes.
Whatever, if I'm at 24 points, my ceiling isn't much higher than that.
Okay.
Like, I won the one that I expect to win, which is the field goal distance.
Right.
I competed in the 40-yard dash. I'm proud of that. Throwing, I have no confidence that I'll ever... Throwing accuracy to me is pure luck.
Yeah.
Like, none of us are hitting that fucking screwdriver, and it's just kind of lobbing it in there and hoping. The only thing that shows me it might not be luck is that I don't do good ever. And if it was luck, maybe one time I'd get lucky. Punting distance, I did okay. I feel good about that one. The best of 10 is probably where I have my best to gain.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like I could do better at that. So my ceiling from 24 points is maybe, you know, a couple more points.
Right.
I feel like your ceiling from where you are is a lot of points difference.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like you have the toughest time with the mental aspect.
Oh, for sure. And that's life in general for me. But with that said, here's my dilemma, Rob. If I say to myself in... May, when we get the date, right? Let's say we get May 7th comes, we get the date, it's November, going to be the same weekend, week 11, right? Now, if I say to myself, well, I haven't never worked out in my entire life. If I start running 2 or 3 days a week, right? And maybe I kick field goals once a month just to try to add a little technique, right? If I do those things, you know, and by working out, I mean running a little bit and maybe just sit-ups and push-ups, right? If I do those things 2 or 3 days a week, then I'm a fucking asshole for getting in shape to win this fucking contest. You know what I mean? So it almost...
You just can't tell anyone.
Oh, yeah. Like, I'm not going to tell somebody. Yeah, I know. I really don't know. Do I try to compete next year with what's in my toolbox, or do I try to improve my toolbox and then have to deal with the flack? I don't know yet. We're going to have to see. But I'm not happy. I am very upset, and I'm depressed.
So, Kern, what'll happen is we'll start kicking some field goals. Joe hits early, so he gets excited, feels good about himself. And I'm off. I can't get anything close. But I know it'll come around. I just keep going. Eventually, I'll figure it out if I just keep going and going and going. Just going off past history. And if Joe boots a couple in a row, that's it. It's I can't do it. I suck. I give up. I can't do this.
Yeah.
And then it's a spiral. It spirals out of control. It can't bring it back.
Yeah, it's not what I do. Yeah.
It's a lot of it is very mental. Because there was a point where I was just kicking them, and I was like, man, there's no way I'm even getting close to 38, rather 42. And then I feel like, it is good to make a couple of short ones and then back it up a little bit, but we're here to get whoever can kick the longest. And it's like, when you know you're not even close, it defeats you on all the other ones.
That's fair, because when I... I'll miss a bunch.
Yeah, I feel that.
I'll miss a bunch, but some will just bounce short. Some will go wide left. Some will, they'll be all over the road. But a couple of them will have the distance and just be way off to the side. So at least I know, all right, if I can just dial this in.
Yeah, I feel
in,
like
so
you
fair.
Could have made nearly a 45 to 48 yard field
that's
goal
fair.
With a couple of those.
I didn't think of it that way, because even when I miss, at least one will get distance and lift where I go, okay, something's going on here. I just keep going. It'll hopefully get better. But if I was short all the time, then it would be harder for me to get up mentally. That's fair.
Yep.
That's fair. Can we talk about when I hit the 42? Can we talk about that scenario?
Oh, yes. You got to tell that story.
I think you would probably tell it better. I would rather be a third party.
Okay.
Telling.
I got it. Yeah. Curran, I just sent you the sheet. So.
If I remember it differently, I'll.
Right.
I'll
so,
interject.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're going to love this, Kern.
So this is kind of at the end of the competition. There's now, keep in mind, it's me, Rob, and Steve, my wife, and Rob's two sons. And my
wife... We've been at one end of the field the whole day.
Yep. We then decided, because of the way the wind was blowing, that we were going to go down to the other end of the field and see if it helped those guys try to kick longer distance. Because at this point, that's the only competition left is
now,
field
I'm
goal
in the
kicking.
Lead at 40.
Right.
So I told Steve I'll follow his lead. Just to be a sportsman, I don't want to be let's go make it easier.
Yeah.
If he wants to go to the other end, I'll go to the other end. If he wants to stay here, I'll stay here. He opts, we should go to the
right,
other end.
Right, because I had already more or less mentally bailed. I was just retrieving balls for those guys. Baby was taking care of the babies, and this is the scenario. So at this point, it's approaching 11 o'clock, and there's some more action around the field. There's a couple people walking their dogs, yada, yada, yada. So a guy gets out of his car and he's walking his dog, and he was talking to Jessica and the kids about what was going on. And then Steve had a couple words with them, and he was just not negative, just hey, we're kicking some field goals. And the guy apparently was maybe a soccer player or something. He knew how to kick. He might have given Steve some pointers.
He did. He told us some stuff.
Yeah, he gave us some pointers.
Gave me some
stuff.
Compliments.
Yeah. And he's so now during this time, I'm still trying to kick a ball here and there. Rob and Steve are making much more valiant efforts than I. So I get up and I attempt a 30-yard field goal. And
we're both lined up though.
Right.
Before you kick it.
Okay.
Before you kicked it is when it happened.
As
you were lining up to kick it.
I kicked it. He saw mine, then set it. And then you.
That's not how I remember, but okay. Okay. Maybe. But it could be.
Yeah, because then
where
that's
was Steve?
Standing kind of at the 50 at the back. Okay. So I had my tee set up at the 30. Rob was behind me at the 42. I kick and it was terrible. One of my worst kicks of the day. So then the guy says.
It looked like an onside kick. One of those ones that you miss and it just.
Yeah. So the guy says. Yep.
Listen to this.
You make this, I give you $100. Because I think as he saw how bad my kick was, he says this. So Rob steps up drills the motherfucker.
42.
42. And I just start screaming, pay him! Where's the money? Pay him! Show me the money! Where's his money? Give this man his money! And the guy's like, oh, what'd he say?
Monopoly money.
And if there were children there, I would have told the guy.
He was so nervous when that ball went through. His heart must have stopped. There's no way he saw that ball going anywhere near those uprights.
Yeah.
I was kicking them kind of long enough, but you know, off to the left, off to the right. He wasn't paying close attention, but we weren't like nailing them. You know, it was like
we didn't look like we were good at kicking.
We didn't look like we knew what we were doing. He says it, and then I kick it, and it was like no time in between.
It was perfect.
He finished his sentence. My foot hit the ball, and it went through the uprights.
It was awesome. Oh.
So apparently that's all I need for motivation. My kid's there to watch and him to put $100 on the line.
Yeah, some fucking total stranger. So with that said, that is the conclusion of this year's Gold-Blooded Dilemma. Next year, like I said, I have some real soul-searching to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. But I might just take steroids, so there's that. So we have a few minutes left here.
Oh, do we test for PEDs?
No.
Oh, good.
I'm going to fuck. I mean, good. I don't know that I'm going to take PEDs, but I'm going to take something. So what we're going to do, we have a couple minutes left here. We just want to get back to 49er football, and we want to talk about the remaining 49er schedule. How many games are left, Kern?
There are
seven.
Six?
Six? Seven? Let's check this. Let's bring the schedule up.
Six
games left. More or less, for the Niners to make the playoffs, they would have to win out and then hope for some other cards to fall in their favor. Right? We could all agree with that?
Yeah.
Not exactly, but it puts us in a much better spot if we do.
Right, yeah. If we have any chance...
If we lose one of these last games, it's not completely impossible, but right. We need to win these games. Yeah,
for sure. So this week coming up, we have the Rams on the road. As most people know, we've had their number, I guess you could say. But
there is a scenario where we finish last in the division and still make the playoffs.
Right.
But it's tight.
Yeah.
More than likely, we need to finish third in the division.
Yeah.
And this division is going to be tough to finish third in.
For sure.
At this point.
I mean, I think at this point, the placement doesn't... It's just strictly record. And to come in third, you're going to need a 9-7 record.
We kind of need to win our division games, and we need all the division leaders to keep winning. Like, the teams that are already a lock that are in first place in all the other divisions need to beat up all the other teams for us.
Oh, no. The Niners could still go 10-6. So... they need to go 10-6, I would say, to have any chance. I think if they go 10-6, they have a good chance.
It also depends if the season gets cut short and they add an extra team.
For sure. So, okay. Kern, did you have anything in particular you wanted to talk about wrapping this up or just go through it?
Just kind of go through it. I was also looking at the Cardinals' final six games, and we have a very, very similar set of games left.
Yeah.
And I think... it could be very tight towards the end, and I think there's a possible way that we finish like, well, I think we could finish third or even come up to second if Seahawks as well, and then
I don't know about that, but
if the Rams start winning, I don't know.
Well, we got to shut the Rams down this week. That's what we have to do. Then the following week, we go back home for a game against Michael Curran's Bills. Which the Bills are, they got a great record this year, right? They've only lost one or two games, so that's not playing the Bills of yesteryear.
I got to be honest, I'm more scared of the Cardinals than the Rams.
Than the Bills? Yep.
No, the Cardinals. I'm more scared of the Cardinals than the Rams.
Agreed, 100%.
Like, just in the division, too, not just in a one-on-one game.
Agreed.
Like, in a one-on-one game, I'm way more scared of the Cardinals than
agreed.
The Rams.
Agreed. Oh, 100%.
But just overall, I feel like... like, the Cardinals are way more of a wild card, and if they get on a roll with Kyler...
For sure. Like, sooner or later, that he's going to be
a
real fucking nightmare.
In this division, the one quarterback that I'm least high on is fucking Goff.
Yeah, oh yeah, no question. So, after the Bills, our friend Alex Smith and the team from Washington come out west, so we have back-to-back games at home.
Alex Smith is a free agent at the end of the year.
Yeah, coming home.
Make a nice mentor for a rookie.
Maybe, or he could fill in at Green Bay when we get Aaron Rodgers, as everybody wants.
Green Bay's got their guy.
Then, in week 15, is everybody, we are going to be doing the Zoom meeting for the 49ers at the Cowboys for a Sunday nighter, 5 days before Christmas. Then 2 days after Christmas, Niners at Arizona. And then we finish off the season with the Seahawks coming to town to play the Niners at Santa Clara. 3Com Monster Park. And for the Seahawks game, the Niners will wear the 94 white throwbacks again. They love rocking those motherfuckers. So definitely not an easy road if we want any chance. We're going to need every guy back, and we got to do the damn thing. And it all starts with this week. Can't lose to the Rams. Curran, you have anything you'd like to say?
I'm good.
No? Babo, want anything you got to say about this?
No.
All right, friend. So this was a little bit of a, you know, little gold-blooded love, you know, talk about our kicking woes. With that said, also next year, I'd like to maybe see the listeners filming and kicking and seeing what they could get. You know, maybe we'll do for the listener that could send a video of the longest field goal made. Maybe we could do a little something. But that might be something to talk about for next year. So with that said, I gave you all the particulars earlier. Email goldbloodedpodcast@gmail.com, Instagram goldbloodedpodcast, Patreon, www.goldbloodedpodcast.com/Patreon, or no, www.patreon.com/goldbloodedpodcast, reviews, however you listen. Our sponsor, as always, is the motherfucking best, Lucky Rose Tattoo, Middlebury, Connecticut. Get your fucking tattoo there. And with that said, we'll check you motherfuckers on next episode. Bye-bye!